There once was a ship that put to sea. The name of the ship was a belly of tea. The winds blew up her bow.
Welcome back, folks. We are about to start our unit on the cardiovascular system and the blood. So before we get too in-depth, just a quick overview of what the system does for us. Okay. So obviously, blood's, circulating around the body. It leaves the heart via arteries, branch repeatedly into smaller and smaller capillaries. And once that blood gets in the capillaries, what's going on is we've got oxygen, okay, all the good stuff coming out. So we want to get water to the blood. We want to get oxygen to the blood. We want to get acids out of the blood. All that kind of stuff we want to get to our tissues. Okay, so that's leaving via diffusion and a little bit of pressure. It's a little higher pressure in the vessels and outside. So we got a little bit of filtration pushing things out as well. And then the other thing we need to do there in the capillaries is absorb all the things we want to get out of the tissues. So we want to get carbon dioxide out of the tissues, waste out of the tissues, get some water out of the tissues. Okay, so we're going to bring in some stuff here on the venous end, which has got a little slightly lower pressure, which makes it a little easier as well. Not perfect. That's part of why we have the lymph system we'll get to in a future unit. So now we got all that stuff going in and out of the blood, the capillaries. So oxygen deficient blood is going to leave those capillaries and flow in veins towards the heart. Okay. Heart's then going to pump it out to the lungs where it can drop off the oxygen, drop off the carbon dioxide, pick up some fresh oxygen, send it back to the heart, and then on out to the body to repeat the process again, dropping off the good stuff, the oxygen, the nutrients, the water, picking up the waste products, and moving them either to the lungs or the kidneys to get rid of them. All right. Now let's take a closer look. The first part of this unit, we're going to deal with the blood. So let's go to that next. Okay. Part one, blood structure. So the parts of the blood, what are their functions and how are they formed? And a little bit with some of the diseases associated with them. So starting off with the composition of the blood. The blood is the body's only fluid tissue. It's composed of the liquid plasma and the formed elements, which we'll talk about both today. The formed elements include the erythrocytes, which you might know better as red blood cells or RBCs. It contains the leukocytes, which you might know more as white blood cells or WBCs, and then platelets. Those are the three formed elements. Okay, so here we can see in this, if you were to take your blood out of your veins, stick it in a centrifuge, you could actually separate those three main components here. And in this test tube, we can see clearly on the bottom, the densest stuff, we got erythrocytes, which makes up about 45% of the whole blood. So not quite half is the red blood cells. The buffy coat in the middle, that consists of the leukocytes and the platelets. The white blood cells in the platelets. And then on the top, a bit more than half of the blood is the plasma, which would be the liquid components of the blood and the things dissolved in that liquid, along with various proteins and things of that nature. Okay. Some physical characteristics of the blood. Blood varies in color from scarlet, like we have here on the left, and to dark red, which we have here on the right. And that is a difference in oxygenation. So blood does change color based on the amount of oxygen in it. But blood is never blue, okay? There's a common misconception out there that arterial blood is red and venous blood is blue, or that oxygenated blood is red and deoxygenated blood is blue. That is false. Your blood is always red, okay? Some people will try to legitimize that and say, well, once you cut open something, it was blue in the vein before, but once it's exposed to the air, it's going to turn red immediately, so you never see the blue. That is not the case. You can go into surgeries or watch some videos where they take the blood, they put it right into a tube, like a heart-lung bypass machine, where it comes, out of the body, into the machine to get oxygenated, then back into the body, never touches, the open air as it's leaving the body. That stuff is red. It's the darker red you see here on the right, but it is still red. That bluish color we seem to see sometimes in the veins, especially if you're pretty pale, that bluish tinge has to do with the way the light shines through the various layers of the skin, the tissues that make up the veins themselves, and then what photons of light and what wavelengths of light are actually able to escape back out to carry that color to your eye. the ones that are coming out are in that blue wavelength, so that's what you detect. Okay. And that's probably in part where the term blue bloods comes from. Back in the past, blue bloods was used to refer to somebody who was in the nobility or the aristocratic and the wealthy. They were called blue bloods in Northern Europe because they were very pale. It was fashionable to not have a tan. If you had a tan, that meant you were a peasant because you had to do a lot of stuff outside. If you were very pale, that meant you were wealthy and rich and could afford to be inside and covered up all the time with parasols and things like that. So those folks would be extremely pale and you'd be able to see the blue veins, hence blue bloods. Temperature of blood is a little bit higher than quote unquote normal body temperature. And normal body temperature isn't normal. There's a range of normal and everybody's a little bit different. It's not 98.6. And if you're a 10th degree over that, you're running a fever. If you're 10th degree below that, you're getting hypothermic. No, there's a range. I run about 97 degrees with an oral temperature is about my normal temperature. Okay. So if I'm running 98.6, I'm actually running a fever. Okay. The average volume of your blood is 5 to 6 liters for a male and 4 to 5 liters for a female is what you'll see in the literature. It really doesn't have to do with whether you're male or female. It has to do with body size. Males are on average larger, so that's why they have a higher amount of blood. Females on average are smaller. That's why they have it. It just has to do with your body size. The bigger your body, the more blood you've got. So 4 liters on the small side, that's like 2 2-liter bottles of soda. And 6 liters is 3 of those. So it's not all that much blood. Sometimes when you watch like a gore movie or something like that, they just got way too much blood coming out of the body for realistic terms. All right, so what does the blood do for us? It does a number of different functions. We've already mentioned and talked about the blood distributing materials throughout the body. That's one of its big things, carrying the materials from various organs to other organs that need it or from different tissues to get rid of it so it's out of the body. Part of that, getting rid of the things you don't need and bringing in the stuff you do, is part of regulating the substances in the blood and thus the substances in the whole body to maintain homeostasis. And then also body protection, both in terms of fighting off infections. There's a big immune component to the blood, but also the blood's pretty good at protecting itself, keeping itself from leaking out with clotting. So you're protecting your body in that way as well. All right, next we have distribution. So what does blood actually distribute or transport in the body? Obviously it transports oxygen from the lungs and nutrients from the digestive system to the various tissues that need those, which is all of them. And then it gets rid of metabolic waste. So metabolic waste, I mean waste from leftovers from doing cellular respiration, like carbon dioxide, or breaking down toxins in the liver, or any other catabolic activities that we're talking about, getting rid of those waste products that are produced by the cells. We're not talking about fecal waste, okay? That's just leftovers from your digestive system. We're talking about waste produced by the tissues. The only way to get that out of your body is to get it into the blood and then get it to the kidneys, where you can filter it out and it leaves in urine, or if we're talking carbon dioxide, it'll leave in your air from your lungs. And also we're talking about hormones from the endocrine glands to the various tissues. So it moves hormones around where they need to go. Regulation. So how does blood help to maintain things? So it helps to maintain the appropriate body temperature by absorbing and distributing heat. We talked about this earlier in the year when we talked about negative feedback loops and maintaining body temperature, right? Your skin is like your radiator. It's what connects you to the outside world. So if you want to get rid of heat, you want to carry it from the core of the body to the surface so that it can escape. So when you are getting too warm, the blood vessels near the surface dilate and more blood rushes to the surface to help get rid of the excess heat. Or if we're getting too cold, we close off those blood vessels near the surface so that the heat stays more in the core and we can't lose as much through the skin. It helps to maintain normal pH or acid-base balance in the body using various buffering systems to reduce the chaotic swing from high acid to high base and try to keep you in that nice narrow range where we want to be. And it helps to maintain adequate fluid volume in the circulatory system. If your fluid volume gets too low, your blood gets thicker and it's harder for your heart to pump it. All right. Now that protection function. So blood prevents blood loss by activating plasma proteins and platelets and initiating clot formation when a vessel is broken. So it's pretty good at self-sealing. It's like a self-sealing tire. It will fill its own hole and try to seal that off as best it can, especially for minor cuts, which you get all the time, frankly. A lot of them you're not even aware of internal, like stresses in the joints and things like that. Blood also helps protect you from infection. It helps to make and utilize antibodies, activating complement proteins, activating white blood cells, all these things to help prevent, keep foreign invaders out of your body, bacteria, viruses, parasites, fungus, what have you. All right. So those are different functions. Now let's take a look at the parts of the blood. So let's look at blood plasma. Blood plasma, like we said before, is over 50% of the blood by volume. And it is the water and all the solutes that are dissolved in it and the small things that are floating in it. So proteins like albumin and globulins and clotting proteins, nitrogenous substances like lactic acid, urea, organic nutrients, you know, those things we're trying to get into our body from our digestive system, like glucose and carbs, electrolytes, okay, these ions that we've talked about in our nervous and muscular system that we use to generate our electrical signals, like sodium, potassium, calcium, bicarbonate, things that are also stored in our bones as well. We talked about it in the skeletal system. And then obviously, respiratory gases like oxygen and carbon dioxide are carried in the plasma as dissolved gases. We actually carry more, particularly oxygen, in the red blood cells, but we'll talk about that a little bit later. Okay. So that was the plasma. Now let's talk about the formed elements, or the things that your body forms or makes, which is why we call them the formed elements. There are three main ones: erythrocytes, otherwise known as red blood cells, leukocytes, otherwise known as white blood cells, and platelets. Only white blood cells are complete functional cells, the nucleus and Golgi apparatus and ribosomes making protein, okay? They are full-out cells, fully functional. Red blood cells, erythrocytes, have no nuclei or other organelles in them. We'll talk about how they're formed later and what happens to all those, but they're just a membrane sac full of hemoglobin to carry oxygen. Platelets are actually formed by another cell, and then they're broken off pieces of that cell that help in clotting. Most formed elements survive in the bloodstream for only a few days or weeks. On the outside, we're talking like 100 days or so, 120 days for some longer-lived erythrocytes or red blood cells. So they don't last very long, okay? So you have to constantly be remaking them. And most blood cells do not divide. They're not just reproducing in your bloodstream. They're actually renewed by cells in the bone marrow, the red marrow that we talked about in the skeletal system. So we'll get to that and how they're made in just a minute. All right, so here we got a nice picture of erythrocytes or red blood cells. We call them a biconcave disc. You can see they look like a jelly donut that's been squished in the middle, right? And that's because they've expelled the nucleus and the other organelles near the end of their development, okay? And that's why I've got the A in a nucleate there underlined and bolded, because A means without nucleus. Okay? So essentially no organelles in them. They are filled with hemoglobin, which is the protein that functions in gas transport. And they're pretty small. They're some of the smallest cells in your body. Discounting the water content, erythrocytes are more than 97% hemoglobin. So they're just sacks of hemoglobin. And the ATP energy they need to maintain their relatively short life is generated anaerobically, or without oxygen, meaning they don't need mitochondria, so they don't have to have those organelles in there, so they got more space for hemoglobin, and they're not using up the oxygen that they're carrying to the other parts of the cells. They don't need oxygen. Okay, they have the pretty low metabolism. And here we can see hemoglobin in the drawing right there. And you can see that in the center of each of those hemoglobin groups, those heme groups, you have an iron molecule, Fe. Okay? You need iron to make hemoglobin. Okay? And we'll talk about the importance of that when we talk about anemia in just a minute. You need iron, and that's also what gives blood its red color. Okay, when iron comes in contact with oxygen, you get iron oxide, right? Rust, which is that reddish color. That is what contributes in large part to the reddish color of our blood. It's the iron combining with oxygen that's in there. Okay. So where do we produce these erythrocytes? And how do we produce them? The process of producing it is called hematopoiesis. That's a fun one to say. You should say it with me. Hematopoiesis. You got to do weird things with your mouth and the lips don't close. Hematopoiesis. I don't know why I have so much fun with that word, but I do. Hematopoiesis occurs in the red bone marrow, the axial skeleton and girdles, as you can see in this picture, and in the epiphyse of the humerus and the femur. Okay, that's where the red marrow is. Everywhere else is yellow marrow in adults. Now, in babies, it's different. In babies, it's just about all red marrow. But hematopoiesis occurs in the red marrow. And the cells that make those formed elements are called hemocytoblasts. Hemo for blood, cyto for cells, blast because they create cells. We talked about that with osteoblasts in the skeletal system, right? So hemocytoblasts literally means blood cell makers. So these are the cells that make the red blood cells and the white blood cells. Okay, so here we can see a nice picture kind of showing hematocytoblasts here, stem cell, which is just going to stay in the red marrow and it's going to keep dividing to produce new red blood cells. Okay, so it divides and the original stays here, and then the new one is going to start down the path of becoming a red blood cell. And you can see early on in phase one and then phase two, you are making ribosomes in phase one, and then those ribosomes are making all that hemoglobin through phase two, just packing that cell full of hemoglobin, because you need, you know, the DNA in the nucleus to give the directions to the ribosome to make the protein, okay? And then once you've made enough hemoglobin, you expel the nucleus and other things you don't need, and all you're left with then is an erythrocyte, that biconclave little disc of oxygen-carrying power. So now there are a lot of disorders associated with erythrocytes, so let's take a look at it. Specifically, anemia, which is a generic term, means the blood has abnormally low oxygen carrying capacity. It's a symptom rather than a disease. So anemia isn't a disease in itself. It's, you might get anemia because of this or because of that. Okay. Blood oxygen levels cannot support normal metabolism. So your blood oxygen is not only low, it's low enough to actually affect other things. So that's when we distinguish it as anemia. Signs and symptoms of anemia. Well, think what you need oxygen for. You need oxygen to produce energy. That oxygen makes your blood brighter. It's in your blood. So you get fatigue if you don't have enough oxygen. You'll be pale. You'll be short of breath. Now, we haven't covered the respiratory system, but if you're short on oxygen in the blood, your brain's going to think your lungs aren't working well, right? So it's going to make you try to breathe heavier, make you breathe faster than you normally would. And it's not because your lungs aren't working or that you're doing too much, okay? It's that you don't have enough red blood cells or whatever else it is that might be causing this particular anemia to absorb the oxygen and carry it where it needs to go. And then you'll be chilled because your metabolism is going to be lower because you don't have enough oxygen. Lower metabolism, lower body temperature, you're going to get chilled. And you can see there's more in this diagram here, more symptoms of anemia. Some are the really severe symptoms if you've got very severe anemia, and then others are less common symptoms of it. All right, so different types of anemia here. So you can have hemorrhagic anemia. Like a hemorrhage means bleeding, right? So hemorrhagic anemia is the result of either acute or chronic loss of blood. Acute means a specific point in time loss. So this would be like you get in a car accident, okay? Or, you accidentally cut yourself wide open making dinner some night with a really sharp knife and you lose a lot of blood, you're gonna have hemorrhagic anemia. You're not gonna have enough red blood cells to carry oxygen because you lost them, they bled out. Chronic means something that happens continually. Loss of blood. And the most common cause of this would be monthly periods that women experience, or menses, right? That loss of blood every month, which is why women are much more likely to have anemia and need to take iron supplements and other things to help them build their blood back up. There's hemolytic anemia, hemo meaning blood, lytic meaning to cut or to break, and that's when your erythrocytes, your red blood cells, rupture prematurely, could be for different reasons, okay? But that anemia, that type of anemia is called hemolytic anemia. The causes are something else outside that. You have aplastic anemia, where your red bone marrow is getting messed up for some reason, like leukemia, cancer, right? And you're not able to make the red blood cells that you need to make. So you either lose them hemorrhagic, they don't last as long as they're supposed to, hemolytic, or you can't make them as fast as you need to, aplastic. Okay, so more anemia, you could have iron deficiency anemia, which is can be a secondary result of hemorrhagic. So if you lose too much red blood cells, too many red blood cells through bleeding with hemorrhagic anemia, then you have to make more blood cells. And if you don't have enough iron to make the hemoglobin to make the blood cells, you're going to not be able to carry enough oxygen. And so that can also happen because you're not getting enough iron in your diet, or you're not able to absorb the iron that you are taking in. So it can be a couple different reasons for that. Okay. Pernicious anemia has to do with B12, which we need to make these red blood cells and absorb the iron. If you don't have enough of it, if you can't absorb it, and we can treat that by actually giving you vitamin B12 and some other drugs, so that's treatable that way. Thalassemias is when you have a faulty globin chain in the hemoglobin, hemoblood, globin chains, and that's where the erythrocytes are pretty thin and delicate, and they're deficient in hemoglobin, they don't have enough hemoglobin, and they break fairly easily. Sickle cell anemia, you may have remembered from when we talked about it in genetics, in biology, it results from a mutation that causes the hemoglobin to become kind of sticky, particularly in low oxygen situations, and it causes those nice round red blood cells to turn into kind of pointy sickle shape, like a crescent moon shape in your blood, and that can cause clotting, particularly in the small capillaries, because capillaries are only just big enough for red blood cells to go through them in single file. Okay, so if you get sickle shaped ones that kind of get jammed in there, you can get clotting, blood won't get where it needs to go, so it can be painful, and it can cause some severe issues if the clots become too big or too numerous. All right, so that's red blood cells. Now let's take a look at white blood cells or leukocytes. They're the only blood components that are complete whole cells with a nucleus and Golgi and all that kind of stuff. They're way less numerous than red blood cells. They only make about 1% of the blood by volume. Something that's a little cool, but a little freaky, if you think about it, is they can leave our capillaries via diapedesis. Okay, meaning they can make, ped means foot, right? So they can actually extend their cell membranes and like crawl through your tissues, okay, to get to an infection. And they can crawl right off the screen, right? They can get out of your bloodstream. They can get into your tissues. They can move around in the tissues, kind of seek and destroy these foreign invaders, which is cool. But then when you think about it, you've got some cells in your body that are able to go rogue, right? They can just go where they want, when they want. So it's a little weird thinking about that. Little autonomous little cells going wherever they want in your body. I don't know. I just find it very cool, but also a little disconcerting. Okay. And they're part of the normal response to bacterial or viral infections. Here we just got some information about erythrocytes. It takes 5 to 7 days to make them in hematopoiesis. And they can last 100 to 120 days, but still not forever. And it still takes at least a week to make the cell. That's why when you give blood, you have to wait a long enough period of time after you give the blood for you to build your blood supply back up and have your proper oxygen carrying capacity. That's why if you're in sports, your coaches don't want you to give blood right before the season or during the season, because your oxygen carrying capacity is going to be reduced. You're not going to be able to practice as well. You're not going to be able to have the endurance you would normally have during your competition. Leukocytes, there's a whole bunch of different types that are specialized in different things. We're not going to get into that so much. But you can see they have, these down here, 6 hours to a few days for a neutrophil. They don't last long. We're constantly making those. And then platelets, those don't last very long either. They're like a week on average. Those are the things that help with clotting. So you can see those there and what they do. Pause if you want to get a little more information. All right, last bit of the formed elements we need to talk about are platelets. Platelets function in clotting mechanism by forming a temporary plug that helps to seal a break in blood vessels. And I'll get more into the details of clotting in the next video. But we can see here in this one, the red blood cells, we can see the tear in the wall of the vessel. And the platelets are rushing into that tear to try to plug the hole. Okay, they're kind of sacrificial plugs. Here in an actual microscope image, we can see red blood cells in right here with the a little bit thinner middle where they're biconcave, and we can see these small purple dots that are smaller than the red blood cells. Those are platelets. And that ends part one of our look at blood. Next time, we're going to look at blood types and some other blood disorders and some various other things about blood. So join me then. I'll catch you on the flip side. So long. Soon may the wellerman come to bring us sugar and tea and rum. One day when the tonguing is done, we'll take our leave and go. Da 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 da.